Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Wardell Room of the Scoble Memorial Library for our talk today, sponsored by the Scoble Library and the Salisbury Association Historical Society. I'd like to make you aware of some upcoming events, if I may. On February 21st, in our Era of Elegance series, Dick Boyle is going to be talking about Ellen Emmett Rand and the exhibit that we created about eight or nine years ago, sort of revisiting some of what's happened since then. On March 7th, Ginny Jones Vale, who's an author who lives in Watertown, and a French scholar, will be here to talk about her book, which was on General Rochambeau from the American Revolution, and she will talk about his passage through Connecticut on the way to Yorktown. On March 21st, Valerie Balint from Olana will talk about Frederick Edwin Church. On April 11th, we are honored to have the Connecticut State Historian Walter Woodward talking about the burning question about Nathan Hale. And then finally on April 18th, in cooperation, in collaboration with the Salisbury Association Land Trust, there will be a nature talk and live animal presentation by Erin O'Connell from Sharon Audubon. So there's our upcoming events. We hope to see you at as many of them as you can attend. Today, however, we are going to hear from Tom Key. As I said to my wife as I walked out the door, I'm going to go find out about the causes of the Civil War from my favorite Southerner. So, so onward we go.
All right. Tell you what I would like to do is take us from the very beginning of the settlements, almost the beginning. Raleigh had a settlement here before 1609 that didn't quite make it, and go all the way up to 1860. And in doing this, I have broken up the time period into about seven different groups. Now, you can't go to a history book, say, from by Catton or James McPherson and find that sort of thing. That's all my concoction on this. So if you want to argue about it, you'll have to argue with me. You can't argue with someone else on it. And in any case, I'm breaking this time period up so we can look at what has happened to the country since its beginning, that kind of separated the North from the South. It started out separating to a certain extent, and this separation ended up in resulting in the first eight southern states and then three others seceding from the Union, and then the Union saying we cannot have that, so we had the Civil War at that time. So the Civil War has been attributed to many things, and it kind of depends upon the time in our fairly recent history that these pronouncements have been made. Most recently, and I think everyone agrees on this now anyway, Civil War is about slavery, pure and simple, and the immediate cause was the fact that Abraham Lincoln was elected by a large majority, and the Southerners said, we have had it with this country because we are both being dominated and being surrounded at this time with the large majority of people that voted for Abraham Lincoln. Not that he was an abolitionist, but he was bound and determined that there would not be slavery in the new states. Southern states, they really didn't care too much one way or the other, at least felt he couldn't do anything about it. In fact, he said in his campaign, he said, I don't know. He said, we really shouldn't be too hard on the Southern people, because if I had all of the powers on earth, I would not know what to do about slavery. In any case, that's the end point. And there have been other reasons for slavery. In the 30s, when people were still reeling from the Great Depression, the historian Charles Beard felt that it was mostly due to economic reasons. And then there have been reasons, maybe in the 50s and such, that people, particularly Southern ones, were saying, no, it wasn't about slavery, it was about states' rights. And then there have been other ideas that it wasn't about any of these, it was really about strictly economic differences and strong-willed people on both sides saying, this is what we want, and if it takes war to get it, we will. So, that's kind of the background of why we're looking at all of this, and let's start at the beginning, oddly enough. The first real settlement that lasted was in Jamestown in 1609. It was a group of people that the historians call adventurers. They had no religious reason for being here. They just felt that this was a place where they could make a much better living than they could in Europe. And about in 1620, we had the Mayflower come over, established in the Cape Cod area. That was maybe a third of the people that came over from a religious standpoint, and they were the pilgrims. Not too long after that, we had another group that came in, I think due to an error in navigation. They were the Puritans. As the definition of the two, the pilgrims just wanted to be left alone to worship in their own way. The pilgrims, the Puritans, wanted everybody else to worship in their own way. A friend of mine once said that the definition of the two was people that were afraid to the death that there was somebody somewhere that was enjoying themselves. Now, down south, though, they took an entirely different approach there. We had Jamestown that was not religiously oriented, and then we started filling in with other places such as Charleston. Now, this whole talk could have been around Charleston and Boston because that's where the focal point of the two areas were. So you'll hear a lot about Charleston in this. Charleston had both the advantage of Huguenots coming in to settle there. And I think 1558, there was the St. Bartholomew's massacre in France, where, depending on who's telling the story, between 2,000 and 10,000 Protestants were killed there. They were dispersed throughout the world. The French, in their short-sightedness, would not let them go to Canada, which would have made a big difference there. So a lot of them came to Charleston and brought financial acumen. Some went to New Paltz, not far from here, and settled. But they made a big difference in the early part of the country there. And in the Jamestown area, after the English Civil Wars in the mid-40s, the Cavaliers, who lost to the Roundheads, the Cavaliers were more of the aristocratic side and represented the crown over Parliament, they came and settled in Virginia. There's no accident that the University of Virginia's nickname is the Cavaliers. And so they brought that aristocratic feel with them. So we had a very different starting, very strongly religious in Massachusetts, very probably hedonistic, at least the people in Massachusetts thought so, in the South. And so from the beginning, they were quite different. Then we go next to the colonial wars. There have been a number of named wars, but the ones that are mostly named we'll mention here. And I put these up here because not that they caused a separation, but that they did not do anything to bring the country together because they were fought in different parts of the country. Now, particularly in the Charleston, Savannah, Richmond area, they had more contact with London than they did with Boston. It was much easier to go from sea over to London, which they knew, rather than going up to Boston, or at least about as easy. So the Colonial Wars, the first of them, first was King Philip's War, when King Philip, I don't know, was an Indian. And that was about a two-year war that decimated a lot of white settlements in New England, Massachusetts, and Connecticut. And but in the end, it really decimated the Indian tribes along coastal New England. And that was King Philip's War. All of it was done in the Massachusetts, New England area. Next, we have King William's War, which was the Augsburg Coalition. Let's see, let me check that one. Yes, League of Augsburg, and it was fought mostly in New England and up as far as Hudson Bay. The next one was Queen Anne's War, which was the war for the Spanish secession. And next we stuck in there the War of Jenkins' Ear. Anybody's curious about why they would name a war that? Jenkins was a ship captain who was trading down in the islands, which were controlled by Spain. His ship was captured, and they cut off his ear and said, if the King of England had been here, we would do the same to him. Now, 7 years later, no one knows why it took so long, he came out to Parliament, took out his handkerchief, showed him his ear. And so, of course, England and Spain then went to war. And that kind of morphed into King George's War. And this, the War of Jenkins' Ear was fought more in Georgia and Florida. King George's War switched back to New England. So the main point, and that was because of the Austrian secession. These were wars that were started primarily in Europe and bled over into the colonies, not big items except for the guys that got killed in the wars. That was pretty important to them. The next war after that is one that really starts meaning something. These meant very little, in Europe, but they were wars that we usually think of would unify a country. They didn't. Next war was the French and Indian War, which was our own private war here. Before we started it, George Washington started it when he ran into the French in the western part of Pennsylvania. And that then bled over into the Seven Years' War in Europe. This would have been called King George's War, but we already had a King George's War, so we called it the French and Indian War. It lasted 7 years. This was probably, during this war, the first attempt to unify the colonies for any reason whatsoever. And Benjamin Franklin, who had been involved in getting the second expedition to western Pennsylvania to fight the French, called a meeting of the representatives of the colonies in Albany, and it was called the Albany Plan. And they tried to get together to help the country, the various colonies work with each other to the extent that it made a better war effort against France. Because up until 1759, the war went very much against the English. And then they had a change of leadership in England. They threw a lot of money at the war, and because of both the French Navy, the English Navy off the French coast, and also the fight at the Battle of the Plains of Abraham outside of Quebec, this was the end of New France. And actually, The French government had more or less written off New France before that. Of course, they didn't tell the guys over here. But that war was the first attempt to get the colonists to work together, and it really didn't work out that well. The fighting was more up there than it was down here, or down in any other place. Then we get to this area here where we have different folks coming into the country. It doesn't mean that there was not immigration in during this time, but it really picked up in this period of time, starting to some extent with the risings in Scotland in 1717, and 1715 and 1745, where particularly after 1745, the Highlands were pretty much decimated by Butcher Cumberland, and a lot of people started coming over to the New World. Now, the people that came over, they were not just Scots, they were also Scots-Irish from Ulster. They were also from the borders of England, kind of the marginal people. And some of the historians have called them the borderers. Now, they took the traditional, I keep looking back like I think I've got a map to point to, but I don't. They took the rather traditional path of coming through Philadelphia, going out through Chester County, Lancaster County, further on out, and then going down the Shenandoah Valley, ending up in Charlotte, North Carolina. And along the way, they kind of spread out, but there is a strip down through there, because in around Philadelphia, Philadelphia was very Quaker at that time, and then there was a band of Pennsylvania German. So these people went further out and then went on down, and then they followed across the mountains, long way around, but that to go by rivers mostly, and then further west. But this group of people that some historians call the borderers were much less civilized than many of the other people that had come on, came over. They were mostly Celtic, and they did not have the refinement that the English had. At the time of the risings in 1745 in Scotland, the Highland people had been compared to the Plains Indians of the United States. They were far, even though the Scottish Enlightenment came along in 20 years from that time, but that was in Edinburgh and entirely different people. So you had a group of rather rough people that went down into the Carolinas, then over into Tennessee, then into northern Alabama, and set up a group that would continue to be marginal farmers at best for quite a few years. So we have different people coming in. The big movement of the Irish and the German came later, say in the 1840s. They stayed mostly in New York rather than going down the route here. All right, in 1734, we started the breaking of the bonds, what I would call it. I think that probably the first real break started with the first great enlightenment, an itinerant minister came over from England into Delaware, and then moved up to do most of his preaching and teaching in New England, particularly in Connecticut. This broke the bonds between the rigid formality of the Congregational Church, because he was preaching that people needed a different religious experience, an experience that was theirs rather than what was passed down to them. by the elders in the church. And this kind of set the stage that, yes, these are protocols, these are the people that are supposedly our betters, but maybe that really isn't true. And I think that that carried over into the idea of we can break off from England and be our own people at this time. One of the first breaks from established control were the regulators in North Carolina. Some of these borderers that I've been talking about later felt that they were being entirely neglected by the people on the coast who had all of the power, and they set up their own courts and they set their own judicial system, ran off the tax collectors, and then they had a small battle at the Alamance Courthouse, and that pretty much ended the regulators. But it was one of these first things that said, okay, we can split off. Now, the country was not, this was strictly a southern thing, it wasn't a northern thing or whatever, it was down there. But it was an idea that things can start changing. And then we have the American Revolution, which started very much in New England, and up until 1778, stayed there in New England. Most of the fighting, other than one excursion, naval attempt to take Charleston, stayed there until the British left Philadelphia and went to New York. The last battle was the Battle of metal block on that one. In any case, outside, it was in New Jersey. So, Monmouth Courthouse. Thank you. I need all the help I can get. So, after that point, things from Pennsylvania north kind of got back to their own way of living, because the British were cooped up in New York City, and they felt at that time, that at least Clinton did, felt, that was the commander-in-chief then, that there was enough difference between the southern colonies and the northern colonies that maybe they could bring the southern colonies along back to the English side if they would put enough force there. So this is what they did. They sent the troops down. They very easily took Savannah and then Charleston, and then worked their way out into North and South Carolina. Cornwallis was the one that was the commander in charge there. And he won a lot of battles, but he ended up at Yorktown. And one of the battles that I will just mention here to kind of follow up on this idea of the borderers is that he was going out into western North Carolina into the Waxhaws, and there was a place called King's Mountain, not because it belonged to the king, but a farmer named King had farmed there. And going out there, he put out the notice that if you did not join up with the British, we would burn your crops, we would burn your houses, and then maybe do really bad things to you. And so this did not set too well, particularly because his whole army, maybe 1,000 people, were made up of loyalists. He was the only Brit in the whole thing. Well, the people on the other side of the mountain, called the Overmountain Boys, met at Sycamore Shoals close to Kingsport, Tennessee, and they said, we will see about this. And so they came over the mountain, and the specific head, commander in charge of this army, had gotten his army on King's Mountain, and they got completely surrounded. I think the Old Mountain Boys were led by John Sevier, and completely surrounded and just about completely wiped out in the battle. The officers first told them, there's no formations to this attack, every man on his own, and they did very, very well that way. And the officers had to stop them from killing prisoners at the end. But when this was over, two-thirds of them packed up, went back home. They weren't taking any territory. They weren't supporting the army anymore. It was strictly a kill mission that they came over because of their feelings towards Ferguson, Major Ferguson, who was the one that said that he was going to burn their crops and houses. So this was the war in the South, and by the time it was over, there was a tremendous amount of hard feelings, much more of a civil war in the South than it was in the North, because there was father fighting father, and brother fighting brother. And after the Revolutionary War, we then really had to decide what we were, who we were. We, first off, in 1776, we wrote the Articles of Confederation. This kind of unified the colonies, though it wasn't completely ratified until, I think, 1781, 83. And the Articles of Confederation was, quote, a bond of firm friendship. That was all of the control that it had over the new states, because these states were as sovereign. They were as sovereign as Switzerland. And they joined this confederation, not a federation, confederation, and tried to get along for a while. But the Articles of Confederation were kind of strange. The president of it had almost no authority. He could call a meeting, and that was about it. He could not enforce taxes. He didn't have any troops to send anywhere. He could not even settle disputes between states. And this was a big concern of a lot of people at that time, that the states could start fighting with each other. The other problem with that, each state had one representative or at least one vote. There was no proportional votes, and there was a big difference in the size of the states, both in population and also, of course, in area at the time. And there was quite a bit of dispute as to how they were going to solve this problem. So the Congress of the Articles of Confederation allowed Madison and some others to try to settle a dispute over the navigation of the Potomac between Pennsylvania and Virginia. Now, when they say navigation, it means more than just driving the boat around. It means trade on it and whatever. And they went down and had this meeting conference at Annapolis, and most of the people that were supposed to show up didn't show up. And some of them that did show up got there late after the others were leaving. So they went back to the Congress of the Articles of Confederation and said, we need to do something better than this. So they were authorized to go to Philadelphia and modify the Articles of Confederation. No one talked about a new constitution. That's what they did. They went there to write a new constitution to try to get some semblance of order in this country, because there were a a number of things going wrong. First off, the group of states had no credit. They had no army. They had no money. They couldn't enforce any laws. They couldn't they couldn't change the Articles of Confederation because they said if it was unanimous when people joined, it's got to be unanimous to make a change in it. So you can imagine how that clogged things up. So when they were writing, got there, and they were definitely going to write a new constitution, they felt. Now, something that I had not realized, that the same time you had the Constitutional Convention meeting in Philadelphia, the Articles of Confederation Congress was still going about its business in New York. And part of the business that it went about was passing the ordinance of the Northwest Ordinance. And what this did, and this is kind of an interesting story I don't have to get into, but some historians think there was a close cooperation between Connecticut and South Carolina on this because they had some similar interests, mostly on export taxes, and of course South Carolina had their interest in slavery, and they also had the issue of representation in this new Congress. Once they decided, okay, we're going to have a bicameral house, we're going to have a Senate, an upper house, a lower house. They decided on one president, not three presidents. They decided to have a vice president, though some people thought that wasn't really necessary. And but then you had to decide, how are we going to let the states be represented in these two houses? And the compromise they came up with is that each state would essentially get one, really two votes in the Senate. The other, the lower house would be proportional. And then each state could decide who gets counted in that. They came up with a 3/5 number for slaves, but who could actually vote was left up to the states. A lot of them wanted people to have so much property. One of them said, well, what if he has a house but no property? One of the other delegates said, well, let him buy property. And so there was not an awful lot of agreement on who was going to vote in this. So they came up with this, but they still felt that the states should be sovereign. Some people did. In fact, at least three, James Monroe, Mason, and Randolph, who helped write the Constitution, would not sign it after it was over because they felt that the states were losing too much of their sovereignty. Patrick Henry wouldn't even attend the convention. He said, I smell a rat. And so even though this got passed, got ratified, you had to have nine votes to ratify it, and nine states to ratify, which they got relatively quickly, but there were two states that they had to have that had not ratified it yet, and they were two big states, Virginia and Pennsylvania. But the main reason they needed Virginia was that's where George Washington was from, and George Washington was already picked to be the president. If he had not been available to be president at that time, no telling what would have happened because they would have changed the office of the presidency. They probably gave it much more power than they should have. Once this was done and the ratification was completed, actually George Washington was inaugurated before Rhode Island even joined the United States. And something that just occurred to me the other day, that the name of the country, why did they name it such really kind of an awkward term. They could have named it Columbia, or they could have named it after Washington and such. But I think that that was a reaction to the fact that these were United States. States is the noun here. United and of America are modifiers to that, that noun. And this is one of those reasons where the states, if you're talking about states' rights, felt that we really are sovereign states. Now, the Supreme Court has said that you weren't and such, but that doesn't necessarily mean that that's the way things are going, as we have found out in the Supreme Court. And several things started happening about this same time. We had Shays' Rebellion, which Washington was very concerned about, and the Northwest Ordinance. And also in 1798, Jefferson and Madison wrote the Virginia and Kentucky Resolves, which more or less said, if states don't like a federal law, they can nullify it. They kind of denied it afterwards, but we'll hear about nullification a little bit later. But there was precedence there that we're not sure that we like this in particular. And then we also had the Essex Junta, Essex from the county in Massachusetts. And these people particularly did not like the Constitution as the way it was going, and they particularly did not like what happened in 1800 when Jefferson was elected president. Now that changed the whole complex context of the Constitution, because the Constitution did not provide for parties. But with the election of 1800, you've got the Federalists, and you've got what they call themselves at the time, the Democrat Republicans. And the Essex Junta began thinking about, at that time, maybe New England just really doesn't fit in this country. And there was a good bit of talk a little bit later after Aaron Burr had been elected, he was elected vice president, pretty much cut out of all activities by Jefferson, because Jefferson hated him. And then he ran for the governorship of New York. And the Essex Junta said, if Burr gets elected, he will take out New York, all of New England, and possibly New Jersey into a separate country. And so, set a lot of precedence for states leaving the country. Burr did not get the Clinton machine, beat him in New York, and then he went on, after he had his duel with Alexander Hamilton, he went on this, what I've called the expedition to somewhere, where he tried to take some people down the Mississippi to take, pull off either parts of Tennessee, Kentucky, and Alabama, or take parts of Mexico as a completely separate country. Because all of this time, you had Spain sitting there. This was right after the Louisiana Purchase. Until that was done, you had Spain sitting there that there was more orientation towards the Mississippi River and to Spain than there was to New England by the people that had crops to sell. All of the rivers run to the Mississippi on that side of the mountains. So there's actually a section of Nashville that was named after the intendant of New Orleans, who was Spanish. And that still was kind of a historical area in Nashville that people really did orient towards Spain. But Spain was really a decreasing power and was not able to back up its claims there or to the Floridas very, very well. And another thing that kind of helped to separate the country was that under the Articles of Confederation, there was concern about Spain's control of the Mississippi, because they did own it at that time. This is before the purchase. And so they sent John Jay to negotiate with Spain to see what they could do about the Mississippi River control over it. And the New Englanders were really not interested in anything about the Mississippi River. What they wanted was Spain, first place, to keep out of war with them. Second, they wanted trading rights in the islands that Spain contained at that time. And of course, the Westerners, Westerners in this context means Tennessee, Kentucky, and maybe Ohio. The Westerners, of course, wanted navigation control all the way down through New Orleans so they could take their product down there and then reload and go to sell to the rest of the world. They sent John Jay to negotiate this treaty, and there were some very strong feelings about it. In fact, one of the broadsides or newspaper headlines was, "Damn John Jay, damn anyone who doesn't, damn John Jay. Damn anyone who doesn't stay up at night with the light on, damn John Jay." So there were very strong feelings about John Jay. And little things like this helped to separate the interest of the country. It had nothing to do with slavery. It was just strictly a difference in the country. And then we get into the War of 1812 after a disastrous embargo that Jefferson put on the products, which hurt this country much more than it hurt England. In fact, it really helped them. And we had the New Englanders again, this exit junta, wanting to almost side with Great Britain. And some of them, I think Nantucket, declared that it was neutral. They were the Federalists, which were the ones that most oriented towards Great Britain, were called Blue Light Federalists because supposedly they would shine a blue light to guide the British ships to intercept any American ship trying to break in the embargo or contraband coming in. And there was a lot of difference of opinion between New England and the rest of the country. And then in 1850, they had the Hartford Convention, which for a long time they thought that this was a convention to actually separate New England from the country. It turned out that they didn't go quite that far, but they almost went that far. But this turned out to be the last gasp of the Federalists, because when the convention was going on, the people in New Orleans hadn't gotten the word that the war was over, and Andrew Jackson sorely defeated the British there. And about the only good thing that came out of that War of 1812 was the fact that the people did feel that this was more of a country that could stand up to the Europeans at that time. So it did work out very well from that standpoint. And the war was really really instigated by the Westerners rather than the New Englanders, who the main cause was for shipping, the impressment of sailors. And of course, people on the other side of the mountain didn't care about that. So it's kind of a strange war at that time. So now we're at 1790. We kind of know who we are now. We have a Constitution, and we are still going in different directions. Mainly, the North is now taking on the Industrial Revolution. And this changed a lot of things. Sometimes we don't realize how much of a change it was. One of the big things was that men were used to working as a craftsman, setting their own hours, working at home. Their wife maybe would help them out. After the Industrial Revolution, then they went and worked for someone else who set their wages, set their time of work, and was a quite a different working environment. And then their wives maybe started working outside of the house also. And this happened in the North. And at the same time in the North, they were expanding to the West. I don't know what was the Ohio and further out, helped very much by the Erie Canal that was completed in 1825 and opened up this whole part of the country to the northern tier. And this was a very different thing from what was happening in the South. In fact, the South really looked down on these tight-fisted farmers and greasy hand mechanics. South said, gentlemen, do not do that sort of thing. And sure enough, they didn't. All they were doing was agriculture. And so this started that long divide from an economic standpoint to where the North was building canals and railroads. Finance was a very big factor here. In the South, you had people buying more slaves. Very foolish thing to do. There have been studies as to whether the South would have been better off if they had put the money into other kind of development rather than agriculture. But at that time, the South provided, I have to read these numbers here, 3/4 of the world's supply of cotton came from the South. Up until 1930s, that was the largest export from the United States, was cotton. And 3/5 of the U.S. exports of the country came from the South. So we said, what do you mean we're doing the wrong thing? It looks like we're doing all right. And the South was wealthier at that time in the North. And a lot of people, in writing the Constitution, one of the two big mistakes they made was they thought that slavery would die out, and they thought that the larger the physical size of the state, the more population it would eventually get, which it might eventually happen like that, but it hasn't happened yet. And so the people on the eastern seaboard were very concerned about the other parts of the country outgrowing them and getting more of a say in Congress. And so during this period of time, the agricultural labor force in the North went from 70% to 40% of the people. The South stayed constant at 80%. 2/3 of the Southerners were not slave owners, but slavery was a big part of their environment. The North was 25% urban, the South 10% urban. For all the money that the South was bringing in with cotton, it was a lot, almost none of it stayed there, because all of it had to go to the North to buy the supplies that the people in the South wanted. So there was no big cash reserve that built up into the South. And so what they had done is put all of their money into slavery and to land. Now, the land was wearing out. And for a number of reasons. Cotton is very hard on the land, and also slave labor had absolutely no interest in improving the land or even staying with it that much. So the Southerners felt that they absolutely had to move west. And then you had the problems of tariffs. The North wanted high tariffs to protect their industries. The South, of course, did not want to have high tariffs for two reasons. If we put high tariffs on imports into this country, places they are sending their cotton to will put high tariffs on that end. Plus the fact they were having to pay higher tariffs on the material that came down. So there was a big problem in mainly centered around Charleston, South Carolina, and John C. Calhoun, who was a senator at the time. And the first tariff question come up in 1824, and then in 1828, the Southerners tried to outsmart the Northerners and said, all right, we're going to introduce our own tariff bill, and it will be so high that even the Northerners will not want it, and so we can say, you shot that bill down. Sure enough, they signed it. They passed the bill. So that became the tariff of abomination, and John C. Calhoun, who had switched from being a nationalist to a very much a regionalist, put out the South Carolina Exposition and Resolves, which said, we're going to not pay the tariff, and we're not going to allow you to collect taxes down here. Well, Andrew Jackson said, the hell you aren't. And he said, if you get 25,000 troops to oppose us, I'd get 50,000. And so this went on. In fact, and Henry Clay came in and came up with a compromise that this was passed, but it came very close to starting the Civil War then. And some people say that if Jackson, as it was Jackson's habit to do, had gone down and hanged a few people, that might have stopped this right there, and there would never have been a Civil War. Or if there had been a war, depending on which part of the country was more ready for a war at that time, but it came very close to it. And so this just keeps separating and separating and separating without anything that brings the country together. There was just nothing that was doing it. And we are getting very close to 1860 now, and that came with the election of Abraham Lincoln. The election was, he had the famous debates with Douglas, and he came out of almost nowhere. Certainly he was not considered a gentleman. He turned out to be our best president before, as far as I'm concerned. And so he was not very well respected or liked in the South at all. Now, one reason he got elected was the parties that had been put together came out of the old Whig Party, the Know-Nothing Party. He had to keep saying he was not a Know-Nothing Party member. And it became the Republican Party. The Democrat, after the Jackson era, they called themselves just the Democrats, not the Democrat Republicans. They had the reverse of what we think of now. The Democrats were the conservative party. They had both a northern and a southern branch that tried to stay together, where the Republicans were the liberal party. And the Democrats were pro-slavery. They were pro-immigration to a certain extent. And they were against public works, all of the things that were important in the North. And at this time, particularly in the 40s, a lot of the German and Irish immigrants had started coming into the North, and all of the immigrant extended to go to the free states. So now you've got all of these free states, and I kind of skipped over the various compromise of 1820 and 1850, but the one that really broke the camel's back first was the Dred Scott decision, which said that a black, I don't care whether he's free or not, he's not, he can't be a citizen, whether he's a slave or not. And the next one, the Kansas-Nebraska Act, which overruled some of the earlier compromises and said that in these new states, it was local choice as to whether it was going to be free or a slave state. So this got a lot of people really spun up on both sides of this. You've heard of Bleeding Kansas. You know, John Brown from Connecticut went out and fought there or massacred out there. And there was this great push to keep these states from becoming slave states. Now, to finish up in 5 minutes here, the interesting thing is that once the southern states saw that Lincoln had gotten such a large majority, they really felt that they were in trouble, that they knew they would not be able to expand to the west like they had wanted to. They felt that they had to do something, and so the firebrands said, all right, we should leave. Each state went out, and then three other states followed. Well, nothing really happened right then, except in Congress, they tried to come up with laws, and there was about 200 proposed amendments to the Constitution. And the amendment that was passed without the southern states by a Republican majority in both the House and the Senate, introduced, I think, by Seward, who's called the Corwin Amendment, and Abraham Lincoln said, okay with me. This amendment said, and it was the 13th Amendment, said, if the southern state will come back in the Union, they can keep their slavery, and that can never be changed. People don't hear about that one too much. It got passed, and it was sent out for ratification by the states. But by that time, other things that intervened, namely the Battle of Fort Sumter. And another interesting tidbit about that, that proposed amendment stayed on the books until 1864, and there was a movement to take this thing off the books. It failed. It was tabled. Now, you can read that any way you like, but I think that what it does is saying there really were a lot of reasons besides just slavery that the southern states said we would be better off otherwise. They had expansion plans, one they called the Knights of the Golden Circle. They wanted a golden circle from the southern states to Texas, to Mexico, to Honduras, to Venezuela, back up to Cuba, all slave states. So they were, and Cuba was a big thing. Even Jefferson Davis, when he was Secretary of War for the United States, who was President of the Confederacy, very much wanted to take Cuba. They felt that that was necessary for the protection of the Gulf states there. So they were expansion-minded, but they couldn't expand. The North was not necessarily expansion-minded, but they were expanding. And so the southern states say, we'll try it otherwise. So that's it.